All right, good evening. I think we'll get started. Thank you for joining us. What a beautifully crisp fall night this is. Doesn't it feel like book festival weather to you? I think we scheduled it right. So my name is John Kenyon. I'm the executive director of the Iowa City UNESCO City of Literature Organization, and I'd like to welcome you to tonight's event. So when we earned our designation in 2008 as the third city of literature in the world, it gained us entree into an international network, but it also gave us a really powerful tool with which to tell our story. And Paul Engle was a very big part of that story. So Paul was a kid from Cedar Rapids who happened to be a talented writer, and he came to Iowa City because he wanted to learn more about writing. Turns out he was a very talented poet. His early collection of poems, American Song, was heralded on the front page of the New York Times Book Review in 1934, where he was cited as a new voice in American poetry. But Engle was not someone you could label with just one title. Poet alone was not going to cut it. And while he did not found the Iowa Writers' Workshop, which is a common misconception, his tenure as director from 1941 to 1965 certainly cemented that program's place at the forefront of American literature, which is the spot that it remains in today. He went on to establish the International Writing Program at the University of Iowa, co-founding it with his wife, Hua Ling. Engle said that all writers of the world should come to Iowa, and he did his part to fulfill that mission. In its nearly 50 years, the program has welcomed more than 1,400 writers from around the globe. And those writers are in town right now, and they are going to be participating in many book festival events throughout the course of the weekend, so I hope you have a chance to see them. And Paul Engle died in 1991 at age 82, having published 14 books of poetry, a memoir, and an opera libretto, as well as a novel. I missed that. His literary legacy lives on in the lives and works of those he helped to educate and inspire. In 2000, nearly a decade after his death, Paul Engle was declared Iowa's Poet of the Century. Then Governor Tom Vilsack declared that Paul Engle's birthday, which is October 12th, would hereafter be known in Iowa as Paul Engle Day, to honor the life of creativity, mentorship, and generosity. To note Engle's impact on our own city of literature, each fall around his birthday, our organization recognizes him with two programs. One is the Glory of the Senses Essay Contest, which awards high school sophomores from across Iowa for essays that were inspired by Engle's work. The top prize is a year of free tuition to the University of Iowa, and we also give cash scholarships to runners-up. Tomorrow, we will honor this year's winning students at a ceremony at 11:30 in the morning at the Old Capitol Senate Chambers, and I hope some of you can join us. The other way we honor Engle is with the Paul Engle Prize. Established in 2011, the prize honors an individual who, like Engle, represents a pioneering spirit in the world of literature through writing, editing, publishing, or teaching, and whose active participation in the larger issues of the day has contributed to the betterment of the world through the literary arts. Our first prize winner was James Allen McPherson, who's a longtime instructor at the Writer's Workshop here at Iowa and the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of Elbow Room. In 2013, we presented the prize to Kwame Dawes, a professor at the University of Nebraska, editor of the journal The Prairie Schooner, and author of the recent poetry collection Duppy Conqueror. In 2014, the prize went to the novelist, poet, and essayist Luis Alberto Urrea. Tonight, we are here to honor our 2015 prize winner. And the Paul Engle Prize is made possible through the generous support of the city of Coralville, which has sponsored the award since 2013. Here to introduce our winner and present the prize is Allison Ames Galstad, who is director of the Coralville Public Library, our generous host tonight, and my thanks to their staff for helping to make all of this possible. Allison's also a member of the City of Literature Board of Directors, so I'd like to welcome Allison to the stage.
I need my librarian glasses, sorry. This weekend marks the end of Banned Books Week, the time each year when we librarians stop to call attention to the books that someone somewhere doesn't want you to read. If you stop at our display near the front desk, you'll see some of the more frequently challenged books, along with reasons why they've been challenged. They use bad words, or they promote witchcraft, or they talk about sexuality, or they express unpopular political opinions. Frequently, these books are for young people, because it is young people whose exposure to ideas we seem to worry the most about. Sara Paretsky was lucky to grow up in an environment where books were encouraged. In fact, her mother later became a children's librarian. But she also grew up in a time and in a household where women were not supposed to get ideas. Though her parents paid to send her four brothers away to school, they told Paretsky that if she wanted to go to college, she'd have to do so in-state, and she'd have to pay for it for herself. She did, earning a BA from the University of Kansas and eventually a PhD and an MBA from the University of Chicago. Though she'd written privately for years, it wasn't until she was working in the insurance industry in Chicago in 1978 that during a meeting with an executive, she began thinking of all the things she'd like to say but couldn't. And V.I. Warshawski was born. Indemnity Only, her first novel, written nights while she was still working full-time, was published in 1981. She has since written 16 more novels in the V.I. Warshawski series, plus several standalone novels, short stories, and a memoir in essays called Writing in an Age of Silence. Paretsky's work has garnered both critical and popular acclaim for nearly three decades. Among her many awards and honors, she was named Ms. Magazine's Woman of the Year in 1987. She received the Mark Twain Award for Distinguished Contribution to Midwest Literature in 1996. The Gold Dagger from the British Crime Writers in 2004, and the Grand Master Award from the Mystery Writers of America in 2011. She holds honorary doctorates from McMurray College and Columbia College, Chicago. After remarks she made in 1986 about the way women in many crime novels were treated and the paucity of reviews of books by female mystery writers, after those remarks set off a firestorm, she became a founding member of Sisters in Crime, the now worldwide organization for women crime writers. With such a long list of publications and accomplishments, it is hard to think of Paretsky as ever being silent or ever being silenced. Every writer's difficult journey is a movement from silence to speech, she wrote in her 2007 essay collection, Writing in a Time of Silence. We must be intensely private and interior in order to find a voice and a vision, and we must bring our work to the outside world where the market or public outrage or even government censorship can destroy our voice. Paretsky has had experience fighting all three of those forces of silence, both for herself and on behalf of others. The Library Bill of Rights notes that libraries should challenge censorship in the fulfillment of their responsibility to provide information and enlightenment, and that libraries should cooperate with all persons and groups concerned with resisting abridgment of free expression and free access to ideas. Sara Paretsky is truly a champion of those tenets of free expression, both in her writing and in her actions, and so aptly fulfills the criteria of the Paul Engle Award. Tonight, we are honored to present the Paul Engle Award to Dr. Sara Paretsky, author, activist, and ally in the ongoing fight for free expression.
I think it will hold a nice amount of black label whiskey.
There you go.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Allison. Thank you, John. I'm so deeply honored and moved by this that I hardly know what to say, so I'm going to read my remarks instead of trying to keep my wits about me and speak off the cuff. But thank you very much. You do me more honor, I think, than I deserve, but I'm going to accept it anyway. I recently saw a museum exhibit on the history of writing, and I felt a sense of awe as I saw myself, one small person, one small voice, connected to a chain of storytellers that stretches almost 6,000 years into the past. Buffalo were roaming widely here when the ancient Sumerians brought the written word to life. Every poem we read, every equation we solve, sadly, every hate-filled message we post online, we owe to that Sumerian miracle. Writing probably developed so that accountants could keep track of land and livestock ownership, but it quickly became the purview of poets. I'm afraid I'm going to break this. I need to put it down. Writing quickly became the purview of poets, and it's to poets, to musicians, to artists that we turn when we celebrate our joys or need help in enduring our sorrows. In the aftermath of 9/11, musicians from America's great symphonies went to ground zero, where they played through the night to support the hard work of the first responders. No one sifting through rubble for fragments of human bodies wanted to hear someone read an accounts payable list, much less an ideological diatribe. They needed music. They needed poetry. One of the first acts of totalitarian regimes is to control the arts and the written word. In John Calvin's Geneva, writers who disagreed with Calvin's vision were burned at the stake. Nazi Germany moved quickly to outlaw, imprison, and kill controversial writers and painters. The 2010 Nobel laureate in peace, and I'm not going to say his name correctly, Liu Xiaobo, spent the awards ceremony in a Chinese prison for writing poetry that didn't uphold state-sanctioned values. And as Allison just pointed out, here at home, while we may not burn writers at the stake, we certainly race to ban books that we find controversial. Last year in Dallas, outraged parents in one of the upscale school districts sought to outlaw books that spoke derogatorily of capitalism. A French writer, Lucien Polastrone, wrote a book recently called Books on Fire, which is actually a history of burned books. And it's sort of shocking to read. It's one of those books that you start reading and you can't put it down because it's kind of so horrible that you don't want to read it and you keep reading it. And it's millions and millions and millions of manuscripts, papyri, books that have been destroyed either accidentally or willfully. And he talked in one section about a library in Belgium which had 2 million volumes in it on the eve of World War I. One person shot at German troops as they came into town, and the Germans torched the building and destroyed all 2 million volumes. Americans helped rebuild the library after the war, and it had grown to 250,000 volumes at the start of the Second World War when German troops again burned it to the ground. I don't want to attack Germany only for this kind of behavior because the United States burned the oldest library in Canada to the ground during the War of 1812. I don't know, we seem to like to torch books as an expression of our fury. Faced with the many millions of books destroyed in the Second World War, some writers, some French writers that Polastron quotes, threw up their hands in despair. They said, what's the point of writing anything, of adding to the world's philosophy or poetry if it has no effect on public behavior, if books are still burned and if people are still massacred by the millions? These writers felt so helpless, so overwhelmed, that they retreated behind a self-created wall of silence. But I have the opposite reaction. I think that the passion that books inflame is proof that they're doing their job and that we writers are doing our job. Stalin murdered the poets Mandelstam and Tsvetaeva, and writers have been burned at the stake, as I said, for their words. Rabbi Akiba was burned by the Romans in 137 AD in Jerusalem. But the words endure. Legend has it that as Akiba's body was consumed by the flames, the words that he had written took physical shape and guided his spirit home to God. A lot of times, some of the reviews of my work are
not perhaps as universally flattering as others, and people object, and readers have written to me in outrage that my books are too political. But I'm really not interested in writing propaganda novels any more than I want to read them. That is, I don't want to read or write novels written only to make a point, to show that four legs are better than two, or all males are testosterone-crazed villains, or that women inevitably use our bodies to make good boys do bad things. There's a reason that the writers we know from Stalin's Russia are Pasternak and Akhmatova, not Nikolai. I always start laughing when I say Gribichev's name because my husband says, why are you still picking on poor Gribichev? But Gribichev, who wrote Spring in the Victory Collective Farm, this long epic poem celebrates Ivan, who worked 24/7 on his tractor to bring in the potato harvest and inspired the lazier members of the collective farm to emulate him. Pasternak may have wanted to make a point, an ardently felt point, about human freedom, about the confusion that we feel in the midst of social upheavals, about how hard it is to know how to act. But he wanted to write about human beings caught up in events, not idealized political types. And that's my goal, too. I guess my literary models, my literary heroes, are Charles Dickens and Elizabeth Gaskell. Both of them were storytellers first and foremost, but they wrote stories against the backdrop of poverty, homelessness, sweatshop labor, and the extreme disparities of wealth in Victorian England. Their books were so effective that we don't see any of those problems anymore. But I think if these master writers could include such topics in their stories, who am I to turn away from them? Contrary to what Allison was saying in her very generous remarks, I'm not very brave. Confrontation makes my knees turn wobbly. I always fear, one of my biggest fears is that in any extreme situation, I would not be a perpetrator, but I would not be that person who stands up boldly and protests injustice. I fear I would be a bystander. Not the person who took part in a lynch mob, maybe, but the one who stayed behind closed curtains so as not to see it going on. So I turn again and again to poetry, to fiction, to memoir that help me see how other people, brave people, thread that needle. I look at Anna Akhmatova outside the prison where Stalin had incarcerated her son. He imprisoned her son to punish her for her poetry. And it was a naked display of the power he had over everyone's life. I look at the Iranian-American journalist Roxana Saberi, whose memoir reflects on her incarceration at the notorious Evin prison in Tehran, her coerced collaboration with her captors, her ultimate road to telling the truth, and her final release from captivity. When I hear from readers that a book of mine has brought them comfort in the night, I feel incredibly honored to be in the company of the writers whose words have sustained me. I think the Engle Award is a shorthand for every writer, every storyteller, poet, painter, singer, whose art has helped another person endure the dark night of the soul. I'm most honored to accept it, and I will do my best to merit it.
Well, thank you very much, Sara. Those were very pointed remarks. I think we gave the award to the right person. By all means. So I would like to point out that the award that we just gave to Sara that she was showing you there was created. It's a one-of-a-kind artwork that was created by artists with MC Ginsberg in Iowa City. We work with them every year to create a unique piece of art that reflects the work and the spirit embodied in our Engle Prize winners. And so I'd like to give my thanks to artist Ji Young Yoon, who worked with us on the design. I believe she's here tonight. So thank you, Ji. Oh, there we are. Thank you. So Sara is represented by the Tuesday Agency, which is a literary-focused speakers bureau based here in Iowa City. When we notified Trinity Ray and Kevin Mills, who run the Tuesday Agency, that Sara was to receive the prize, they suggested that we bring Maureen Corrigan to town to do a Q&A with Sara to round out the event. We, of course, jumped at that opportunity and would like to thank the Tuesday Agency for sponsoring that part of our event, so please help me do so. And I know Trinity and Kevin are around somewhere, so you can say thanks yourself afterward. So you're in for a real treat tonight. Maureen Corrigan is one of America's most trusted and beloved book critics. Her distinctive voice is at once incisive and accessible, like a well-read friend. You've heard her on NPR's Fresh Air. You have read her in the Washington Post. And if you're smart, you've picked up her engaging recent book, So We Read On, How the Great Gatsby Came to Be and Why It Endures, which was named one of the 10 best books of the year by Library Journal. Now I would like to welcome Sara and Maureen to the stage for what promises to be an enlightening Q&A. So please help me welcome them.
Can people hear us? Yes. Okay, good. It is such a pleasure for me, Sara, to be here with you and to be present as you receive this award tonight that you so justly deserve. For as long as you've been writing, I have been reading you. And I've been reviewing you, and I'm not one of those critics who says tone down the social criticism. In fact, knowing that I would be seeing you again tonight, I went back and looked at my reviews of your oeuvre. And I wanted to read a couple of sentences from a review I wrote of Blacklist, which I have a memory of coming out last year or the year before, but it's actually 2003, so time really, time flies. But about Blacklist, which is a terrific V.I. Warshawski mystery. If you haven't read it, as its name suggests, it has a plot that harkens back to the McCarthy era as well as the present. But I said, without sacrificing the mystery plot to politics, the Warshawski mysteries have investigated social issues such as homelessness, corruption within the Catholic Church, medical malpractice, industrial pollution, and the overarching question still of whether detective work is indeed a suitable job for a woman. What's particularly amazing about the Warshawski books is that, unlike many other long-running series that eventually begin to run on empty, these mysteries have grown richer and more ambitious with age. And that is true. That's certainly true of Brushback, your most recent book.
This is really embarrassing. Thank you so much.
I want to press you a little bit more on the topic that you really spoke about so beautifully in your acceptance of the Engle Prize, and that is, how do you meld what Graham Greene called the entertainment, you know, aspect of the mystery plot with the social criticism? Because I think what you do so seamlessly is that you write these novels that are novels of ideas, novels of social criticism, and yet you don't sacrifice, you know, the suspense, the entertainment. This is a novel that really deals with so many social issues, but I think chief among them, the stranding of the working class, especially in Chicago, where V.I. Warshawski operates, when factories, warehouses, industry just left the south side of Chicago, and the community there was stranded and really fell apart. And on that note...
Right. The Koch brothers who run that power company... Yeah.
That was good.
How can I answer this question? Thank you, first of all. I need to just thank you for those generous comments. But in some ways, I'm a very undeliberate writer. Mm-hmm. I write out of the things that I feel passionately about, and hopefully the passion won't leave me, because I think that that's what makes it possible to join story and, well, issue, for want of a better word. I think the crime novel, it's where law and justice and society come together in a natural way, and so it's a good place to explore issues that seem to me to be all about injustice. And I'm not interested in, I'm terrified of street crime, of course. I live in a city, I live in a neighborhood with a pretty high crime rate, and I don't want to be mugged or shot or any of those things. And I agree street crime is a worrying problem and needs to be addressed, but I'm not interested in writing about it because... this answer, I need to make the answer shorter, but... You had mentioned before we actually sat down questions of class, and I think street crime, in a way, crime writers like to write about street crime, and it becomes a class issue. It's them and we, the reader, the writer, are kind of separate from what those dirty, nasty people are doing out there on the street. Whereas I think that street crime is just one fallout from serious injustices and malfunctions of, this sounds so pompous, but of society. And I was thinking, one of the novels that I wrote, a lot of my novels, the ideas for them are triggered by events in the news. And during the savings and loan crisis, which you may remember in the 80s, where we spent $1 trillion to bail out banks that had been deregulated and had just run wild. And so many people were, elderly people were left without their life savings as a result of the way the savings and loan crisis unraveled. And I started reading about old people who were in prison for shoplifting to try to feed themselves, or people who committed suicide. And the death toll among elderly Americans as a result of the just rapaciousness of people like Charles Keating was outraged me then, and it outrages me still. And so I see these as huge crimes. And then the question becomes, as a writer and a storyteller, what I was telling the kids at the Iowa Youth Workshop today is that it's detail that makes a story come to life. It's not big picture, it's small picture. So my real struggle as a writer, what slows me down and has me do many iterations before I get to where I can really start the book, is how to bring the big story down to where it's a person that you care about who's affected by it in some way. Is that...
I was trying to be fancy in my question, and what I could have really asked you is, do you start with the problem, or do you start with almost the plot? I mean, but it sounds like, in a way, the mystery plot and the social problem grow together in your mind. Yeah. You open Brushback with a classic opening for a mystery novel. V.I. is in her office, and the door opens, and a client walks in. And almost always in the classic film noir or detective story, it's somebody from the detective's past. And sure enough, this kind of out of shape, balding guy who V.I. doesn't immediately recognize turns out to be Frank Guzzo, who was her first lover when she was a teenager.
Right.
The past always comes back in detective fiction. And we were talking a little bit before we came out on stage. As you say in your memoir, detective fiction, hard-boiled detective fiction, is one of America's literary gifts to the world. But it's a form that's obsessed with the past, about not being able to escape the past. And this story drags V.I. back into the old neighborhood, into old relationships that she thought she had left behind. My question is, isn't there something ironic about this quintessentially American form, the hard-boiled detective fiction novel, that's obsessed with the past and tells us that we can't escape the past? And you, as an activist who has to believe in possibility and change, here you are, you stuck know, spending your past. Life writing this, stuck in the past, yeah.
Well, I'm going to have to think about that one because I've started work on a new novel that's also stuck in the past. I don't know. I think also as I age and the country of the past becomes so much bigger in my own life, it weighs on me more heavily. Also, as I age, there are issues from the past that I'm now more... I'm strong enough to engage with maybe that I wasn't when I was younger. And my books, in a way, are always personal. I mean, they're personal to me. The story comes out of something that's personal to me, a passion or a piece of history that maybe I don't want to... I'm not Virginia Woolf. I'm not going to write it out as my life in print. But it does... I guess I'm sorry. It was just my husband is in high energy physics, or he was during his active career. And one night at dinner, one of his colleagues turned to me and said, "Well, he had studied history, but he hated history because it was so you couldn't nail it down, you couldn't prove anything." And to me, that's the what draws me to it is that it's. It's a shifting landscape constantly. Your own personal history, who said what to whom, who got the biggest piece of pie after dinner. You know, the siblings are all going to argue over who got the most love, and how much more so is it when we think of our own past. And then it's the interpretation of the past that drives current debate and current policy and. I'm really muffing these questions because they're.
Oh my God, it must be my fault.
No, you're asking questions that are deeper than my brain wants to go. But I don't see how you can really build a bridge to future action if you don't see where you're grounded, and. Hopefully, at the end of any V.I. novel, you know, she isn't like a Robert Ludlum. She's not a born conspiracy person. She can't cure the CIA, the FBI, the NSA, the KGB, or any of those things. But her job is to make one or two lives whole and to open possibility for a person or a handful of people. And also, you know, in some ways, like in Blacklist, the challenge I set for myself in that novel was I wanted to try to create a villain who, in many ways, was someone that I admired. And so I have a publisher who builds a huge kind of progressive publishing empire on a really shocking lie. And the woman is very close to her teenage granddaughter, and it's kind of V.I.'s job. She's kind of like Virgil taking Dante through the underworld. It's V.I.'s job to take this teenager, Catherine, and teacher what, and you know, the shock and the terrible unraveling of that relationship, the closeness between grandparent and grandchild. V.I. also has to guide her past being undone by what she finds out. So the future is the possibility that now this girl with this fortune and this is going to use this history to make change that will be for the better. And so I think in that way, it's crucial that you know the past, that you don't just jump in and and take action without some grounding under it.
You make it sound very mythic, that the detective hero almost has to go underground back into her past in order to come back out again and make things whole.
Those myths, they reflect that in us, maybe. Mm-hmm. You know, when I wrote a non-series book called Ghost Country, and I got what I really wanted. I came home from watching The Magic Flute, and I was furious. I thought, I love Mozart, but really, come on. The Queen of the Night has to be punished for daring to stand up to the male authority figure, and I was on my high horse, and I was going to write an opera that was like, not being Paul Engle, I never actually wrote the libretto. So, but I did all this research, and I thought, what we need is the goddess Ishtar to come back to life and just fix these guys once and for all. And so I started doing all this reading about ancient Sumer, and it turns out that the Sumerian goddess of life and death and birth and war, Inanna, that she dies, and she goes to the underworld, and on the third day she rises again from the dead. Her best friend gets the queen of the underworld to release her. And so I think it's a strand that goes through somehow we need that sense of getting into the ugly part, the part that forces us to think about our mortal end in order to have a chance to thrive.
Can I ask you some more about your own past? I mean, we
you
heard
can ask
a little
me anything,
bit,
and I'll try not to buff too many of the answers.
This Sarah's memoir, Writing in an Age of Silence, is a very powerful book, and you do talk about your parents. You don't share the same kind of background that you gave V.I. V.I. comes from a more blue-collar background, but her parents, in their different way, seem to support her desire to be something more, to make the class climb out of South Chicago. Your parents, your dad had a PhD. Your mom was accepted to medical school and then didn't go, but she had a college education. But yet, when it came time for you, the only daughter, and you had four brothers, to think about going to college, they did say to you, if you want to go, you go to the University of Kansas and you pay for it yourself. How do you understand that difference, that distinction?
Well, I think it's very complicated in looking just at them and their lives. I mean, certainly my father, in his professional life as a university professor, he was a great mentor to his women students. It wasn't that that he tried to keep women out of the profession. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, he was someone who needed a huge amount of adulation. So he was always rather confrontational with his male students who didn't adulate him the way the women did. But at home, he was really, he was both in some ways a domestic tyrant, and also, both of my parents were just very needy people, and to them, I don't think they were wonderful to their sons any more than they were to me. But their neediness, they wanted a caretaker, and that caretaker would be the girl. And so I don't think they sat down and thought it through. I think it was just very much out of
a sort of emotional chaos.
Did they live long enough to see you get your PhD, you know, move into the professional world? They did, yeah. And what was their reaction?
Well, that was complicated also. So when I left for the university, I came to Chicago in 1966 doing community service work, sort of on the fringes of the civil rights movement, and came back to Kansas and finished my undergraduate degree, and then I wasn't staying there. So I moved to Chicago, and I got a job as a secretary, and then I won a fellowship at the University of Chicago. And when I told my parents, my father said, "Well, just remember, it's a first-rate institution, and you have a second-rate mind, so don't be surprised if you fail." But then, in the end, when I started publishing my novels, mm-hmm. his name on a book jacket in a library, that was so, so everything changed at that moment.
Interesting. That's interesting. You write in writing in an age of silence that second wave feminism is certainly one of the crucial things that helped you find your voice.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And amen to that. And again, we were talking a little bit about this before we came out here, but it seems like you now have these younger female characters who crop up in the mysteries. And I'm thinking about V.I. has a much younger cousin, right? Mm-hmm. Petra. And in this novel, all of a sudden, her late cousin, Boom Boom Warshawski, the hockey player, he has a goddaughter who comes and lives for a while with V.I. And they're younger women who V.I. is kind of a mentor to, but I feel like she has to sort of impress upon them the necessity for feminism. They're just different in terms of their political consciousness, their self-presentation. They often flirt a lot to get what they want. And I wondered if their characters are based on, you know, your sense of what you see meeting students, meeting younger women, you know, this generation, the younger generation, needs to be reminded of what they're taking for granted.
Yes, and I don't know how much, I don't really know how much good that does. Like, you girls don't know what it was like. I was thinking of Billie Jean King and Rosie Casals really forcing the World Tennis Association, Federation, whatever it is, to start giving women real prize money and to take them seriously. I have a friend in Chicago who's about 90 who was a semi-professional tennis player, and back before Billie Jean and Rosie, the big tournaments or the small tournaments, they didn't have professional line judges. Those were reserved for the men, and it was women like my friend Betty who were called on to act as umpires and line judges and so on at the matches in whatever town they were in. And today's generation of young tennis players don't necessarily, I mean, they're stars and they take it for granted. And I think in a way that's true of a lot of what's happened with women's lives just in the short few decades that I've been an adult. You know, when I started college, God, we had to fight for the right to stay out of our dorms past 10 at night. You could not borrow money in your own name. You either had your husband or your father co-sign the loan. It was just the list of things that had to be fought was very long. And to some extent, the fact is that many of them were never really won. Mm-hmm. And yet there's a gloss that says, yeah, we have all this now, and so we don't need to keep working and pushing on this. And and I don't want to always be feeling like a perpetual victim, but yeah, I think of things like this Gamergate uproar of about 6 or 8 months ago where, and I can't remember the woman's name, but she was reviewing video games. She was not saying, let's censor video games, let's take them off the market, let's... All she was doing was writing reviews, and she noted how much degradation there was, rape, dismemberment, all the stuff that you see in the Mo Hayder, Alex Lemaitre novels brought live onto a video game. She got death threats. She got like 10,000 death threats in one day. Her phone number, her home number was posted, her home address, graphic descriptions of how she ought to be violated and dismembered, and her parents' phone numbers and address were posted, and threats were posted against them. So the idea that you have a voice, that you take up space, and I think in some ways this is my visceral, thing, voice, the ability to take up room, and as soon as you really assert that, the pushback, the blowback is just, it's ferocious and it takes many forms. I just want to say one more thing about that, and that is that there have been a number of studies, and most recently one at Yale, of analyzing male and female speech. And in general, if women speak more than 30% of the time, whether it's in social settings or business settings, everyone, both men and women, start discounting what we're saying and shut us down, shut us out. And I have a friend who's a partner at one of the monster law firms in Chicago, and she said, you know, she's 40 years old, so she's the next generation down. She said she has to be very careful in partner meetings on how to pace herself when she's making a point, because that's exactly what happens. And so I think that for me, young women, they need to understand voice and room. And, you know, we talk a lot about the problem of obesity in America, but we don't talk about the problem of women making themselves too small.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. You mentioned another topic, so I feel free to bring it up. Let's talk about age.
Okay.
I noticed that the epigraph to Writing in an Age of Silence is from Tennyson's Ulysses, which is a poem about aging.
Right.
To seek, to strive, to find, and not to yield, right? I think you're one of the few mystery writers I can think of, certainly, who makes use of the potential of the detective fiction series as a form to almost be writing one long epic novel. And you are slowly aging, V.I. Warshawski. There's a passage in Brushback after V.I. has endured a bad street fight. And she says, the climb up the stairs to my own place seemed as hard a journey as the drive across the city. When I got there, I sank into the tub, pouring in eucalyptus oil for my aching eyes and nose. Maybe I was getting too old to take the risks I needed as a private eye. Surely I could compensate by getting craftier. And she goes on and on. I would love to see V.I. I mean, what is she, about 50 now?
Yeah.
I would love to see you take her further into the country of the older. I used to look at V.I. when I was younger as one of the role models in literature for how to be autonomous, how to stay within yourself, how not to be a people pleaser. Because she's a good role model for that. I want a role model of how you age energetically and mentally and engagedly out there in the world. Are you thinking of doing that?
I want that model too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm getting close to 70, which I understand is the new 90. I think I, in a perverse way, I've been lucky. I've had a partial long-term disability for a number of years, and so I just feel like that's who I am. I don't feel like, oh, I'm getting old, I can't do these things. I just have for many years been someone who couldn't do many of the things that I wish I could do. I have a cousin who's my age who right now is backpacking in Kyrgyzstan and camping out on the mountainside. And I'm like, well, I'd be doing that if I didn't have this little bit of a disability. You know, I could do that. Yeah, I could do that. So in some ways, I suppose there are models out there, and how do I incorporate that into VI and do it believably is a really good question. And I also think in some ways it circles back to what you were asking about earlier with young women and you know, I know that there are wonderful young women out there who are picking up the load and starting to carry it, and yet there's a way in which I think my friends and I still feel that it's our responsibility, that we can't, that we're not allowed, or we don't feel, it's not even a question of being allowed, we just still feel so passionately committed that we're not ready to completely duck out of the fight and leave it for a newer generation. And so in that way, how do you age and how do you stay vital and how do you stay connected, and yet how do you not, how do you pay attention to the fact that your aging body needs more rest and so on? Those are all really good questions. And then also, I still want VI to have a really vital sex life. VI gets to do many things that I don't get to do, as well as having to take some of the abuse I don't have to take. Mm-hmm. I need to sort out those issues, because I think you're absolutely right.
I have this fantasy that Kathleen Turner, who played VI in the kind of, I wasn't happy with that
movie. No,
especially because the first shot of VI in that movie was of her high-heeled leg.
Yeah, God, that pissed me off.
But now Kathleen Turner, I could almost see her
right,
coming back.
Yeah, and if Disney would ever let go of the rights, let us do it.
I want to ask you one more question and then open the conversation up to the audience, because I know people want to ask you questions. You're the president of Mystery Writers of America. One of your stated aims is to shine more light on diverse detective fiction. And I applaud that. I just also wonder, though, that it seems to me there was this explosion, of course, in the 80s and the 90s of mystery writers of color, gay and lesbian mystery writers, and you know, the detectives also, who were formerly sort of on the outside in traditional mysteries, they were now the detectives, so these detectives who were other. But with the demise of specialty bookstores, you know, feminist bookstores, gay and lesbian bookstores, bookstores that really highlighted books about people of color, with the shaky state of publishing, I haven't seen as many detectives come on the scene who kind of represent people who haven't been represented before in detective fiction. Can you give us some recommendations?
I can, but not off the top of my head. This is really frustrating as you were talking. I wrote an essay about this that ran in Booklist in their special mystery issue in May.
Okay.
And it's on my website, and it does have some names in it. Mm-hmm. But one of the and I'll be glad to go back and repost that and repost the blog about it. I mean, I think one of the things that's happened with bookstores are starting to make a comeback. That was good news. There's been about a 20% increase in indies in the last 2 years, so that's significant. A lot of writers that I really love, like Valerie Wilson Wesley, they stopped writing crime fiction because they couldn't find a market for it, and turned to, and I think she's writing more romance and erotica now, and that's been true of a number of writers of color who were really good writers, and it's kind of like I don't know. I mean, the Amazon sales model is not one that's conducive to diverse and multiple voices. And Amazon controls about 60% of all books in all formats that are sold in America. So that's essentially a monopoly. You really have to know what you're looking for when you go into that massive site in order to find it. It's not going to just pop up at you. And so it's just been easy for publishers to slough off the titles that aren't selling in the tens of thousands of copies. And also, I think the conglomeratization in the industry. I mean, when I started, there were about 40 separate houses. There are now 5. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are a lot of local. I mean, there are hundreds of small local presses, but distribution is a problem for them. But New York is really dominated by big 5 houses, and they want it fast and they want it easy. So they're looking for the next James Patterson or Gillian Flynn. They're not looking for the next unique or idiosyncratic voice. There's also a sense, I mean, I think my favorite rejection letter when I was trying to sell my first book, or my agent was, came from, I think it was Simon & Schuster, who said that a novel set in Chicago had regional interest only, and that not enough people read in the Midwest to make it profitable to publish a book set here. And I think there's that attitude, that very blinkered attitude towards African American readership, or a Hispanic readership, or a GLBT readership, that it's just not on the radar. And so our mission, you know, which is very slow getting off the ground, but still very heartfeltly embraced by the board, is to come up with ways of forcing the industry to see that readership. And we have a couple of initiatives, and one of them is to start sending recommendations to libraries for their mystery book groups, and that's one of the things that's on my website. And if I'd known it was going to be on the test, I would have.
but we all have access to your website.
Right,
so
saraparetsky.com, and I'll repost.
Great.
So that it's fresh and up there on the main page.
Great. Well, shall we open things up to the crowd here? Okay. Yes.
First, I have to say, I'm a fourth generation Chicagoan. I got to say thank you for studying Chicago. Every time that I love the books in totality, but it's like going home. And I know everywhere she's going, and I know every spot she's in. But one thing I want to ask from the new book is, currently my brother died in last January, and his kids wanted to scatter his ashes all over Chicago, meaningful places. And of course, Wrigley Field was one of them. And they kind of gave up at the end, you know, that they weren't going to get in there and sprinkle the ashes. and did it in a cantina bar nearby, and surreptitiously in a planter. You can use that if you want. But there's a scene where they break into really feel the night. Did you check that out? Is that even possible?
So the question is about Wrigley Field, and the woman sadly lost her brother last January, and his children were sprinkling the ashes in places that he really cared passionately about, and they couldn't get into Wrigley Field. And then she read in Brushback about how V.I. broke into Wrigley Field in the middle of the night, and was this possible? So back when I was selling computers to insurance agents and doing sales promotion and marketing in the insurance industry, I had I guess I was the client of a guy who had a $1 million ad budget, and people would woo me for my ad budget. And one of the magazines, architecture magazines, the advertising manager, he was 80 then, so I'm sure he's not still with us, but he told me how during the Depression, when his family didn't have 5 cents to put together, he would climb the girders to the L and shinny onto the platform and ride to Wrigley Field and then climb up over the back of the bleachers and get into the bleachers. Now, physically, it's a lot trickier today because they cantilevered out the back of the bleachers. And I did go and photograph it all and study it, and I could see how VI, who is so much more nimble and a lot more upper body strength than I have, could make it happen. It wouldn't be as easy as it was in 1935, but it could be done. And so, take it to your nieces and nephews. Tell them to go dig up that planter from the bar. And, the trouble is, of course, as baseball has become very corporate, they now have armed guards there. It's just not as much fun as it used to be. Anything else? Yeah.
Well, long ago and far away, but not that long ago, 1981 at the University of Kansas, I was at a university function, and as happens in those situations, you overhear little tidbits of conversation. And there were two professors near me, and one of them said to the other, "Oh, what do you hear from your daughter? How's the book coming?" and he said, "Well, it's at the publishers now, and they're dealing with that." And he says, "You know how that goes." And I'm wondering how you remember that time. I'm wondering if you had a mentor or somebody who helped ease this along at all for you. And do I understand you currently do that kind of thing for other writers coming up?
The question had to do with when I published my first book, and did I have a mentor, and how did that play out? And I wrote about 70 pages of what became Indemnity Only, the first book, and I thought, I don't know what I'm doing. I can't make this happen. And then Stuart Kaminsky, a crime writer who sadly died a few years ago, but he taught at Northwestern, and he taught a class in the night school called Writing Detective Fiction for Publication. So I took his class, and he was enormously supportive and told me some things that I really needed to change, and he was right. But he liked the character, and he liked the concept, and kind of helped me get over the psychological hurdle of completing it. The second part of the question was, do I do that kind of mentoring now? I really don't. I don't have I don't have the time for it because of some personal issues that absorb a lot of my discretionary time. I have done it in the past, and maybe I'll be able to do it again in the future, but not right now. However, MWA, the Mystery Writers of America, is starting a national mentoring program. And for a very modest fee, you can submit, I think it's 100 pages of a manuscript to a senior writer who will read it and critique it for you. And hopefully in the future, I'll be able to start taking part in that. Yeah.
the Midwest division of the Mystery Writers of America already have a mentoring program for new writers.
Yeah, the Midwest chapter has been doing that, and the New York chapter, some of the chapters have been doing it on their own for a number of years, but it's now a national program too. Yeah.
My favorite quality of V.I. is her physical bravery, which, you know, then translates into, you know, pursuing things even when she doesn't have a clear idea of what she should be doing next. I guess I'm just curious about, you know, why you endowed her with this quality and how important you think it is.
The question had to do with how physical V.I. is and why did I make her so physical. And I think it just does go back to what Maureen and I were talking about being a palpable presence in the world. When I started writing about her, I wanted her to be physically substantial. So she's about 5'8", and she's about 150 pounds, so she takes up some room. I also, when I started writing about her, was the era of Modesty Blaze with her amazing karate and so on, and I wanted V.I. to be a credible street fighter, so I had her grow up around the old steel mills, and I don't live that far from those dead mills. My stepsons who lived with us, they had friends from that neighborhood, and there was one young woman in particular. She was a crazy person. She was not very big. She had red hair that came down to her knees. She liked to go into bars and chat guys up and have them buy her drinks, and then if they actually made a physical move on her, she'd beat them up. And she could handle herself in a fight. So I was thinking, you know, in that neighborhood, girls grew up in three ways, main ways. Either their parents sent them to convent schools and kept them under lock and key, they became mothers at much too young an age, or they were like this young woman and really learned how to defend themselves on the streets. And to me, that was how I wanted V.I. to be. And in some ways, I mean, my husband calls me a pit dog. He said, I'll go down and sink my teeth into anyone's calf as long as they're four times my size. And I don't have the physicality to make good on it, but she, I think, for me, she's the physical embodiment of what goes on in my head. And, you know, in my real life, I'm a middle linebacker. Am I not seeing any hands in the back? Because I don't want to ignore anyone in the back, but the theater lights are kind of in my eyes. Yeah.
Could you talk a little about the development of Lockie and her inclusion as a recurring character?
The question had to do with Lottie Herschel, the doctor who's V.I.'s good friend, mentor, surrogate mother, all of those things. And Lottie started as just a walk-on. You know, I didn't know what I was doing when I started, and I was very nervous about it, and could I write a book? And so I'm following the conventions of the form, and I'm writing with the little sister open in my lap, and I read a lot of Rex Stout. And in the Nero Wolfe books, Doc Vollmer up the street is always patching up Archie or their clients, and so I thought, what a good idea that is. Only there was an abortion underground in Chicago, Jane, an abortion collective. I wasn't active in it. It kind of was, I didn't know about it until almost the end of it. But I had V.I., whose birth year has shifted consistently with time, be part of that, and that Lottie was a physician who had counseled the women who were doing it and teaching them how to do a D&C. And And so that was the start of their relationship. So it was always a little bit more than just Doc Vollmer up the street. And then I think, as a Jew born right at the end of the Second World War, with the kind of the weight of that survivor guilt in my parents' generation, and the loss of my entire family in Europe, too hard to think about, too hard to come to terms with. And Lottie's from Central Europe, not from Eastern Europe. She's kind of as close as I can bring myself to get to that history. So in some ways, she has, over time, become this really important emotional bridge for me for dealing with my own history and my own past. And so she plays all those different roles. What a load she carries. She looks after V.I., she looks after me, she takes care of her patients. Yeah.
But she, you know, her role speaks to what we were talking about. She has that social charge. As you say, she's more than just Doc Vollmer up the street. And she also takes V.I. back into the past, or the series back into the past. Mm-hmm. We've run out of time. Thank you so much, Sara, for talking to all of you.
A book festival program. This will tell you about everything that's still going on Saturday and Sunday. Highlights include a lot of panel discussions, a lot of readings all day tomorrow. Robert Reich, former Secretary of Labor, will be at the Englert at 7 tomorrow night. Brian Stevenson, who is a fantastic speaker and civil rights attorney, will be speaking at the IMU at 2 o'clock on Sunday. This will tell you everything you need to know. Thank you again to everyone who helped, Coralville Public Library folks. I think I'm on now. I won't repeat everything I said, but thank you to the Coralville Public Library, Allison and her staff. We have a reception that the folks and the Friends of the Coralville Public Library are putting on immediately following here, the foundation, excuse me. And Sara and Maureen will be signing books that will be sold in the back, so please stick around and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.